officially beginning committee of the whole. Our first agenda item, let's just get right to it. Future Heights housing update. Deanna Bremer Fisher is on with us. Unless if you have an introduction, Susanna, I will let Deanna take over.
Oh no, Deanna's ready to roll.
Okay, Deanna, please.
Okay, well, thank you. Good evening. We're pleased to be here tonight to share with you our progress on the Future Homes program. And what I'm going to do is share with you my screen so that you can see our presentation with, okay, so hopefully everybody can see our presentation. We do have several other people from Future Heights who are on the call this evening. And just very briefly, we have Abby Lawless, who is in charge of the Future Homes program. She's on staff at Future Heights. We have Bob Brown, who is our current board president. We have Julie Sabroff, who is our incoming board president. Micah Kerman, who is chair of our Planning and Development Committee. And Mike Beyer, who is chair of our Future Homes Committee. So they're all on the call. I'm going to be presenting to you tonight, but they are here to answer any questions that you may have. I've got lots of photos to share with you, as well as some statistics. And I will try to get through this fairly quickly so that there's plenty of time for you to ask any questions that you have. So first of all, you're all aware that we have a two-year development agreement that began February 1st, 2019, and is up for renewal on February 1st, 2021. In the first year, we had the goal written into the agreement to do 5 housing rehabs. And in year 2, we had the goal to do 7 rehabs and 2 infill housing projects. The goals of the program include the following: reducing blight, promoting homeownership, stabilizing and increasing property values, showing how 20th century houses can be modernized to 21st century living, and preserving the architectural character. And as you remember, in 2017, the city passed adopted a master plan that identified 2 target areas in the city. One, the mid-city target area, and the other, the Noble Monticello target area. These are areas of the city that need more investment, where we were seeing declines in property values and where we wanted to concentrate our efforts. We decided that in year 1, the best place to start with housing was in the mid-city target area. And in gray, you can see the area that we identified as our target area. And the area tightly around the high school is our model block area, just an area that we are concentrating even more resources on to try to make a greater impact on a concentrated area. So we wanted to be strategic in how we went about this. And we needed to start somewhere within the city to make a big impact. And we decided to start in this area because there had just been the renovation of the high school and the improvements to the Lee Road streetscape. So we knew that those were assets that we could leverage as we began rehabilitating houses. In red, you will see all of the houses that are currently in our program from the target area, 2 of which are directly across the street from the high school, others that are in our target area, and 2 that are actually outside the target area. So although we've identified a target area, it doesn't mean that we won't consider rehabbing houses that are outside that area if needed. And these were 2 homes that residents and the city said really needed to be renovated, and so we were happy to do that. But you can also see then that we have 6 houses that are within the target area. Here's a chart of where the Future Homes program stands. These are all of the homes that we either put through the program or are in process or even just beginning in the program. So you can see that we have 4 homes that are complete. The rehabs have been completed and they have sold. You can see the pre-rehab value of those properties, and you can see what those homes sold for so that you can see the increase in value of those properties. You can see that many of the properties come from the county land bank, and some of them are coming, especially the more recent ones, from the city land bank. You can see that we've worked with three different developers in this program, and we are happy with the work that they are doing and want to continue to work with them, although we're also looking for new developers to work with. You can see that there are properties that are currently in construction, a couple of which are nearing completion. So our property on East Overlook and both properties on Washington are nearing completion. The house on Berkshire, which is one of the ones that you walked through, we expect to be complete, or we hope to have complete, within a month or so. All of the infrastructure has been done on that property, and it's really more of the finishes that need to be completed. We've got three properties that came from the county where we're in process of selecting a contractor to work with. And then we have four additional properties that are all in the Noble neighborhood that have just been transferred to us. And those are in the pre-development stage, which means that we are going through those properties. We are developing the scope of work, and we will then post that scope of work and put it out there for developers to bid on. And then we will select one of them to work with for each of these homes. 2009 Goodnor was the first home that went through our program. You can see the before picture and the pre-rehab value. It was the first one to be completed. It sold within 3 days of listing, and you can see the improvements there. Here are some of the interiors. Many of these homes, when we get them, are in really poor condition. Many of them have to be cleaned out before we can even see the condition of the interiors. But as you can see from these photos, we're able to get them to a very high standard. And although these photos look really nice, the other thing that you need to understand, and I think those of you who are able to go through the tour, it's not just cosmetic. We do a lot of work on the infrastructure of the house, the HVAC, the windows, the electricity, the plumbing. So there's a lot of work that goes on to these homes to bring them up to standard, not just fixing violations, but bringing them up to 21st century standards of living. 2036 Hampstead was the next home. And this is another example of the value that we add to the program. This is a home that where we were able to increase the living area in the home by finishing the third floor and the basement. We added a full bath and we totally rebuilt the garage. And you'll see a picture of the garage shortly. So you can also see the rehab value and what it eventually sold for. So here are our pictures, after pictures of the interior. You can see when the kitchen was totally gutted and what it currently looks like. We were able to restore many of the historic features in this home, such as the hardwood floors, keep the cabinets and the fireplace. So there were many attractive features that we were able to maintain in this home, as well as I mentioned, adding living space, adding a bathroom, and adding value to the home. This is a picture of the garage before. There are actually three cars in this picture, one of which is underneath the collapsed roof of the garage. So the garage was totally rebuilt. You can see where we finished the attic. We also finished the basement, or a portion of the basement, added a full bath to the basement. And you can see the brand new HVAC that has been installed in the house. Cedar Road was the next home that went through the program. And this really kind of went through the program during the first part of COVID. So we don't have a lot of after pictures to show you, but this was another instance where we had to completely rebuild the garage. I'm sorry. And we were also able to add some living space. We were able to finish a portion of the basement and add a full bath to this home as well. Cummings Home is the fourth home that has been fully completed. This home was in a severe state of disrepair, overgrown landscaping, a collapsed garage. So we had to completely rebuild the garage. And as you can see with the after pictures here, we do the landscaping. It was another one of those homes that was really in poor condition on the interior. There was graffiti, personal belongings, etc. We were able to open up the floor plan a little bit on this home, as well as completely redo the kitchen and the baths. And you can see some pictures here. We were able to preserve the beautiful hardwood floors and the beautiful fireplace, but add modern amenities. There are two-family homes that are currently going through the program. Both of these are nearing completion. One of them is on Washington, and the other one is on East Overlook. And I have to say, I mean, these duplexes have been a bit of a challenge for us. Ours is a program that really looks to find an owner-occupant for the home. So when the home is put on the market, the requirement is that it be sold to an owner-occupant, and that's actually written into the deed. So there's a deed restriction that says that it must be owner-occupied for the first 2 years. And so we see that as a real value to our neighborhoods where we're increasing home ownership. And with duplexes, it's obviously a great opportunity for somebody to purchase a home where they can then rent out the other half of the home and oftentimes pay for their entire mortgage through that rent. However, it's a concept that that nowadays people don't understand as much as they did perhaps when these homes were built. So we're finding it a bit of a challenge as we are wrapping up the renovation of these properties and putting them on the market. And it's causing us to think about, should duplexes be part of this program that is geared towards homeowners, or should we perhaps tweak our program a bit when we're working with multifamily structures? This is the home on Washington that you toured last week, 3315 Washington. It's a beautiful, or was a beautiful four square home, and it's going to be a beautiful four square home. Originally had four bedrooms and one bathroom. It will, when it is complete, have five bedrooms, including a master suite on the third floor that includes a full bathroom. We also added a powder room and a coat closet to the first floor. Amazing to think that was not part of the floor plan when the house was built, but it was not. This is another case where the house was, the landscaping was totally overgrown. We don't have that photo here. This is a photo of after the landscaping had been cleared out. The porch was in severe disrepair. There was a hole in the roof. There were windows that were missing that were allowing water and the elements to come in. So you can see with these before pictures, the damage that was throughout this house. This really was a house that, quite honestly, was a candidate for demolition. We were fortunate that we were able to save the garage rather than having to rebuild it from scratch. There was a big tree that had grown into and compromised the back wall of the garage. We were able to remove the tree, remove and rebuild that wall of the garage and save the rest of it. And that's one of the things that made this project doable for the contractor. So this is one of the homes that you were able to walk through. As you can see, the landscaping has been improved. We worked with Heights Tree People to have a new tree planted on the front lawn of this home. The photo of some of our council people are on the third floor looking at what will be the master suite with a full bathroom and a beautiful large bedroom that could include an office or seating area. And you can see the rest of the home. You can see where we've added the powder room, et cetera. And then you also were able to tour the home at Berkshire. So this is a home that had been vacant for, I believe, 10 years or more, and was a real eyesore and a problem for the neighbors. The neighbors had been trying to take care of it the best they could, but I think they were happy to have it come into the program. It was originally four bedroom and one bath. When we complete the renovation, it will have five bedrooms and three bathrooms. So we've really been able to increase the living space that is in this home. And as you know, as you went through it, you saw that the landscaping is beginning to come in. The repair to the front porch is in progress. We are able to save the hardwood floors and the beautiful fireplace in the living area. We also were able to add closet space. I mean, this is something also in many of our early 20th century homes, there were teeny tiny little closets that really weren't usable. So in the bedroom, the upstairs bedrooms, we were able to create usable closets, which I think will really add to the value of this house. And so just moving on, the properties that are coming into the program now, many of them are in the northern part of the city, in the Noble Monticello target area. And as you can see from this map, there will be 6 homes that are going through the program. They're all marked by the orange squares. There are 3 of them that are up here in the Caledonia neighborhood. And then there are 3 of them that are, I would say, by the middle school area of the neighborhood. So 1 on Yellowstone and 2 on Elbon Road. And you can see how we have Elbon Road kind of highlighted here. And that's because we are doing 2 properties that are basically across the street from each other. We think we have an opportunity to create another model block area, another area where we can look at putting some concentrated resources to try to improve the property values in that neighborhood for the residents. Now I'll explain a little bit more about that in later on in the presentation. So these are the homes that are going to be going through the program. As you can see, the 2 on the bottom here are on Elbon, and then the Yellowstone house is here, and then the others. And then the Sycamore house is one, it's south of Mayfield, but that also is a house that is going to be going through the program. And I wanted to show you our scope of work. I want to say we are constantly learning about how to improve this program. When we started, of course, Future Heights had never renovated homes. So this was a brand new program for us. As you know, we brought on Abby Lawless to work on this program, a new staff member. And we did not have the expertise on staff at that point to do a program like this. We were very fortunate that we have many experts on our board of trustees who have been able to help us learn how to do a program like this. And Abby has learned quickly. She's done a fantastic job working on these initial homes, and we've had quite a bit of learning from them. Sometimes as we were going through the properties, we had surprises. We thought that the contractor had understood a particular thing that we wanted, and sometimes we were surprised, and then we had to ask the contractor to redo something or rethink something. And so one of our learnings was that we need a much more detailed scope of work moving forward. Here's an example. This is the scope of work that Abby has worked up for the Sycamore Road property. This is page 1 of 8. It's very detailed now, where we go through each item and give very detailed instructions to the contractor about what we expect. And it includes photos as well, so that there's no confusion. When we start off a project, this is what we're expecting. And as we go through it, we can refer back to the scope of work and point out to the contractor exactly what our expectations are. So this is an improvement that we've made. Our original scopes of work may have been 1 or 2 pages. And now, as you can see, this very detailed scope of work for the Sycamore house is 8 pages. And then there is infill development. So year 2 of our contract asked us to begin 2 infill houses, and that was the goal for that. And of course, when we set out that goal, we didn't necessarily know how difficult it would be and what all the steps would necessarily be in terms of finding developers and getting a program off the ground. We researched a lot of vacant lots and neighborhoods within Cleveland Heights. We talked with many developers about the possibilities, and I'm very happy to say that we've developed a relationship with Knez Builders. They are doing houses, new houses in University Heights. The picture on this slide is one of the homes that they are doing. And as you can see from the picture, they are able to build new homes that are in a traditional style that would fit within a neighborhood. This particular neighborhood, actually, I think this particular house would probably fit better on most Cleveland Heights streets than it would next to this ranch. But this is the type of home that they are able to build on the size lots that we have at a price point that would be affordable and would enable them to cover their costs of building, which is incredibly important. So we've identified 19 vacant lots that are in the area just south of our target area of the high school. So in that mid-city area, just south of Cedar Road. And these are lots that are adjacent to the lots that they are building on and being successful with in University Heights, which is why they are very interested in starting there. So there are five lots that they are interested in. I'll show you a map in a moment. Our requirements are that we want homes that are compatible with the surrounding neighborhood. And we also want homes that have modern amenities. As we've been talking about residents, about the types of things that they want in homes, one of the things that comes up again and again is the need for a first floor bedroom and bath suite, so that as people are aging, they have that amenity. As you know, most of the homes in Cleveland Heights currently do not have that feature. So it's a housing type that we are missing. So you can still get a home that fits in with the surrounding neighborhood and has this feature. Kinez has built homes with that feature in other areas. They've built in Cleveland, they've built in Shaker Heights, they've built in many communities in Northeast Ohio, and they do good quality work. So we're in the process of working with them and with this city to develop an agreement. In fact, we've got a meeting tomorrow to talk more about that with the city. And the city is calling phase two of the neighborhood redevelopment program. We are also available to assist with phase one of the neighborhood redevelopment program, which are the RPRQ that the city has issued for the DeSoto Altamont neighborhood and for the Mila View neighborhood as well. Here's a map of where those lots are located. So you can see that many of the lots are located south of Cedar Road. Some of them are located north of Cedar Road, really adjacent to and within our mid-city target area. You can see the ones that are circled, which are the five that they are interested in starting with. And not surprising, I mean, these are the lots that are closest to that border with the city of University Heights, where they've already demonstrated that there is a market for this and they can be successful with this. So these are the five that they'd like to start with. And as they have success here, then they'll be interested in building on the other lots as well. And it's our hope that either Kinez or other builders will see this success and want to build in other areas of the Heights. So let's talk about years three and four. And that's, I think, you know, really why we're here tonight to talk with you about. We are very interested in renewing our contract with the city. We're very thankful for the investment that you've made in our organization. It's enabled us to add to our staff and add to our expertise. So here's what we envision for year three. Now that we have the program up and running, we believe that each year we'll be able to do a minimum of 8 to 10 rehabs, depending on the availability of the properties from the two land banks. We believe in year three that we will be able to start those five houses with Kinez and support the city's infill program as well. We have a plan to expand our mini grants program, and I'll talk about that in a moment. We have had a neighborhood mini grants program that has invested more than $30,000 in 40 some projects throughout the city. And we believe that in expanding it to include some housing improvements would be very beneficial to our neighborhoods. I mentioned earlier that we're looking at another model block area around Elbon Road, where we are planning to renovate the two houses. And we're also looking at comprehensive strategies. And I really think this is important, and this is where I think our partnership with the city is really important. Completing one rehab and having it stand alone, certainly you can add value with one house, but where you really get, where you can really leverage your investment is when you're doing multiple houses, when you're doing other improvements. And these can be things like community organizing, planting new street trees, other placemaking projects. On the slide here is a picture of the garden that is at the Roanoke and Noble property. This was an initiative of the neighbors, and it's a placemaking opportunity. And so these types of improvements working hand in hand with the rehabilitations and the new houses can really improve a neighborhood much more so than any one of those initiatives by themselves. And then for year four, continuing with the rehabs and then developing the additional lots with Kinez. Just a little bit more about this idea of mini grant expansion. And this idea really came to us as we were working on the two properties on Washington. They're almost side by side, except for there is one house in between them. And this is the house, 3311 Washington. Not sure how well you can tell from the photo here, but it's in need of paint for its beautiful front porch. And there may be some city or county programs that the homeowner is eligible for, but there also may be gaps, or as we know, sometimes those programs run out of money. So the idea behind our mini grant expansion is that we would make money available to homeowners in our model block areas to make exterior improvements. And these could be things like paint. It could be fixing a roof, or fixing a porch, fixing gutters, or doing landscaping. And there are some of those things, such as landscaping, for example, where there are no county or city grants to cover something like this. But our program would be flexible enough where we could offer small grants to these homeowners to encourage them to make improvements that would then help leverage the other investments that are going on in the neighborhood. So the future is bright. We're very excited about continuing this program. We're very grateful for your partnership. We think that this is a very important work, addressing blight in our neighborhoods, attracting new homeowners that are going to be paying income taxes and property taxes, transforming some of the worst houses in the neighborhood, and making them some of the most desirable homes in the neighborhood. We currently have 11 homes in the pipeline. And as I said before, your investment in us has enabled us to expand our capacity and our expertise that we'll continue to build on as we move forward. We're working to institute best practices and ensure that all of the work is of the best quality that it can be within the budget. We're very pleased to have brought Kinez to the picture and are looking forward to starting some new homes with them. And you know, where it all comes down to is creating these neighborhoods that are more vibrant, that are stable, and that are competitive. And that's important for all of us. So again, you know, we're very happy to have your support as we do this program, and I'll be very happy to answer any questions you have. So I'm going to stop sharing so that.
I do not have any questions at this time. It was a great presentation. Definitely went a little longer than I expected. It was a very good presentation. I appreciate it, Deanna. And getting to walk around on Berkshire and Washington last week, that was amazing to see the change going on in those homes that just a few years ago we would have been demolishing. But due to economics, it's something that is such a great thing for the street. Did anyone else want to ask a question, say something, Khalil, please?
Thank you. I had a few questions. The first is sort of what criteria do you use to select the developers that you want to work with?
So there are several criteria. We have an application. We ask the developers to tell us about properties that they have already completed. So we want to see, have they already done this type of work? What's the quality of their work? We ask for recommendations. So when Alan Butler gives us a recommendation, we take that seriously. If when somebody applies for our program, we ask for recommendations. When we started the program, we had recommendations from the city of Cleveland Heights, from the city of South Euclid, from the city of Cleveland. So recommendations are important to us as well. We look at the company's finances. Do they have the ability to complete the scope of work? And we also, certainly now, as we are getting multiple bids for properties, we're also interviewing the developers, making sure that they understand what it is that we're looking for. And we're asking them about, what investment you're planning to put into the property, so that we have a good understanding to make sure we're on the same page in regards to the amount of investment that we're expecting them to put into the property. So there are really multiple things that we're looking at as we vet each of the contractors.
All right. At this point, are you planning to take a look at minority representation in workforce or in ownership, women-owned businesses and female workforce numbers for any of these developers or contractors?
Yes, we are. Thank you for bringing that up. I mean, that is another initiative that we're looking at. We are asking for that information on the application now, where we hadn't in the past. And we also we did some outreach to try to reach new minority and women-owned contractors that perhaps had not heard of our program before. And we are now in discussions on what types of goals. I mean, it's a little bit tricky because it's not a huge number of projects, and yet it's a very important thing for us. So yes, we are looking at ways that we can put in metrics to measure that.
Okay. Another question. So I know that you mentioned in conversation, talking about comp creation, you want to create a situation where things are appraising for and selling for higher numbers, and that'll help the surrounding neighborhood. And I'm wondering, I know the county land bank and the county housing program, part of their program has to do with comp creation. And so they're looking at targeting based on certain criteria that they have down to a science at the county land bank. And I'm wondering, have you considered, or are you working with them, collaborating with them on sort of the data that they're looking at to see where they might want to target their comp creation efforts?
We are, in conversations with the county about their programs as they develop them. But we often, and with the city as well. We have a pretty good idea of where we want to create comps. And I think there's a lot of overlap, in our goals and their goals. So I guess, the basic answer is yes, but we'd like to see that continue.
Okay. Were there any, I know you mentioned sort of the needing to evolve the scope of work over time, realizing that you needed to be more specific. Were there any other mistakes or hiccups that you encountered that you sort of had to adjust during the process?
Yeah, I mean, there's been many learning opportunities. I mean, I think that was probably the biggest one in terms of scope of work, but also just making sure, for example, that our contractors are posting their permits, and following those rules, making sure that they know that just because we're there and we're checking in on them every week, they still need to, follow those types of rules. Yeah. What other learnings? The two families, I mentioned the two families, and I think what we've seen there is that it's more challenging with a two-family. Oftentimes, those have been rentals. They are in poor condition. The one on East Overlook had structural issues that needed to be addressed. And, you know, often the budget is not there to restore all of the features that you would like to. I mean, that house is covered with aluminum siding, or it's aluminum siding. Would love to see that taken off. It's just not in the budget, you know, to do something like that. And I'm a historic preservationist, so, you know, I always want to, and one of the things I should mention that we do is that we ask the county archives for a historic photo. I think it was in the 50s when the county went around and took a photo of every single house. Some of those photos have been lost to time, but in many cases, the county archives has them. So we request that photo. We take a look at that photo that gives us an idea of what that house looked like back then. And it was much more likely to have its historic features then than it might now. You know, and then we use that as our goal. And again, oftentimes the budget doesn't enable you to restore everything, but it is something that we talk with the contractors about.
Okay. So I'm thinking, we walked through, I saw the energy efficient water heater, the, you know, new HVAC, all of these things, new duct work. I'm wondering, is there sort of, are there other efficiency or sustainability requirements or efforts that you're looking at maybe now or down the road? I'm thinking about like R value of insulation, sort of, you know, as close as possible to, you know, complete efficiency kind of stuff. Is that a focus for this program, or are we looking at sort of, let's get this first part right first, and then we can focus on that other part later?
Well, I mean, energy efficiency is a focus of the program as well. I mean, so they are adding insulation. I mean, many of these homes, as you know, don't have adequate insulation. They are replacing HVAC in many cases, so that you're getting the efficiencies of modern utilities there. In many cases, and again, you know, I'm a historic preservationist, but the realtors and the city itself is asking for replacement windows. And part of that is energy efficiency. A big part of that is, you know, lead paint abatement and that sort of thing. We are asking that when they replace the windows, that they put in a similar style to what had been there. There are many instances where the choices that they are making are improving the energy efficiency. We don't have as a goal to make it, the most sustainable home that it could possibly be. But in many of the choices that they're making, they're increasing the energy efficiency of the home.
Okay, and I just have sort of two last questions. The first you just brought up, I'm wondering, so lead abatement. You know, a lot of Cleveland Heights homes are pre-1978. And so I'm wondering, are we testing for lead? Are we encapsulating? How are we addressing that potential issue?
Yeah, I mean, the contractors are taking all of the precautions that they need to. There's a house on Elbon that we're going to be using the CDBG funding for. And I hadn't been aware that there were certain contractors that are certified by the city for lead abatement. And so we are looking at a contractor who meets that requirement for that house. And so that's, you know, again, chalk it up to more learning, that there are those types of certifications that we now know look for.
Okay, and the last question I have, I think.
Okay, Khalil, just let me just cut you off just real quick. You can ask your question, but I just want to remind everyone that we do have Metro waiting for us. So please, let's, you know, try to move it a little quicker. If we can send an email, let's send an email. But if you feel you need to ask a question now, then you are welcome to.
Actually, you know what? This is probably best. We can talk about this another time, or you can email us. I am looking for any constructive criticism or any compliments on the interaction with the city during these renovation projects, like, you know, any permitting, ways that we did well, ways that, we could improve, you know, think about process improvement and that kind of thing. So I'd like to hear your input on that. And we don't have time probably to go into that experience. So I'm looking forward to that later, I guess. So thank you.
Okay, great. I'll be happy to address that in an email, but just let me say that city staff has been great to work with.
Okay, Mike, I saw your finger up first. Oh, Mike, I'm sorry, Mike, your turn.
You're muted.
Thank you. Sorry, I can't, my unmute button, it was disabled, just like my muting button was disabled earlier. No, I just want to piggyback on what Jason said. We've got really important guests waiting. You'll recall that this came about, this presentation by our friends at Future Heights came about because Council Member Sarin and perhaps others questioned the efficacy of the work in light of the upcoming contract renewal. I just want to say thank you, big thank you to Deanna and to Bob Brown and their colleagues. I think Future Heights is doing transformative work in our community, as evidenced by the presentation tonight. We're lucky to have a team like this, but comprised mostly of volunteers, I just point out, and really knowledgeable folks who whose only purpose is to bolster and strengthen our community. So I just want to say thank you, and I look forward to renewing our contract in every way possible and continuing to forge ahead. Thank you.
Okay, Davida, you're next.
Yes, I want to thank you for the presentation. The homes that I was not able to go to because I was working, looks like they were up to speed and very well done. But in the same breath, I am truly disappointed that at the presentation for three to four year period, that there is nothing happening in the Noble area. We have six houses out of all of the houses that's being rehabbed. We have vacant lots that Grayton Road, we could probably do a whole block of brand new homes there. Noble and the Taylor area cannot wait 3 to 4 more years for any activity in that area. I've met with you. I've had Zoom meetings with the gentleman from Building America regarding to help in the Noble area. We were going to put together a development table. Tim has called me several times for California to want to know are in that process. I have not heard anything. So at this point, I'm really disappointed because I am looking for something to happen in the Noble Taylor area. And just to give us six homes out of what's been happening because I pressed at the last meeting is not acceptable for me in the area in which I live. Everything is going still to the other side of town and is not coming to the area where we need to really be focusing at totally. I mean, all of council has said that. Every resident that we have talked to have said that. It, through walking the neighborhoods, even on the south side of town, has said that the areas that needs to be have attention to is the Noble and Taylor area. And until we can do something to make those areas better, I'm not happy with that. Although you're doing very good work, I'm not happy with it. I'm not happy that nothing is being focused in the area that needs to be focused in, where we can uplift those property values. We had a resident actually give us an email, public form, that she had. We had so many lots on Grayton Road that if we have someone who can build homes there, we need to have somebody build homes there to uplift that area. If we can't put resources into an area that is truly needed, I don't know what we're doing. I really don't. And I'm a little upset because I've been waiting and waiting. I've been patiently, and most people of council is not aware of the meeting that we had with Building America from California, willing to help us do different things in the Noble area, whatever we can, and ask that we put together a development table where we can all come together and talk about what we could do in this area, and nothing has come about of that, nothing. I've called, I've sent emails, I've asked, where are we with this? Nothing. So I'm a little, I I appreciate the work, but I'm truly, really upset right now. So I'm going to stop before I say too much.
Jason?
Melody, go ahead, Melody.
As we go to the next contract, which will start in February, it seems that it would be a wise choice for us to make sure we specify the areas where we might want the development to be, so it's clear.
I think that's a great suggestion, and that is something that we should be discussing as a council about focusing the areas. Mary, sorry, you know, Melody, did you have a follow up?
No, that's what I wanted to say.
Okay, Mary.
So we have this RFQ out for a big part of the northern part of the city, don't we? And so it seems to me that, I mean, that was for 40 homes up in north of Mayfield. So I'm a little astonished that, or don't they, don't, doesn't that part of town count where those are focused? Anyway, that's my two cents. Or my question or my comment.
Yeah, so I think you're referring to, you know, the RFQ that the city put out for development partners, and I did participate in the meeting that the city had. A couple of potential developers have called me, so we are, you know, making ourselves available to have conversations with them as they get ready to submit proposals for in response to an RFQ, which I believe is due on December 11th. And as many of you know, and I didn't make it a focus of the presentation today, but Future Heights has been working very diligently on the Noble Road Corridor planning project. So we thought it was very important after we had done a housing study of the neighborhood that there needed to be investment along the Commercial Road Corridor. Again, we have had several conversations with developers and brokers about development opportunities in the Noble area. We're working with Noble Neighbors on an early action project to install benches that will then be decorated with artwork that celebrates the neighborhood, and working with them on you know, other initiatives, community building initiatives in their neighborhood. So although the first year of our work was concentrated around the high school, there has been quite a bit of work that Future Heights has done in the Noble neighborhood, and we're very excited about starting the housing work in the Noble neighborhood with the six homes that we have. And that work is just underway now. So, you know, I hear DeVita's sense of urgency and desire to move quicker. And I really wish we could. And it has been somewhat frustrating, you know, especially during COVID with some of the delays we've had, everything from, you know, documents to building supplies and even labor in terms of working on these projects. But we look forward to continuing and trying to pick up the pace there.
I just cannot at this point accept any excuses for that. I understand you're trying hard. I understand Noble Neighbors are doing their best as well, but to be frank and honest with you, Noble Neighbors does not represent all of Noble and Taylor area. It's not flower pots and benches are very well, but that is not upping my property value. That is not upping the property value of the people who live in our community. And Noble area and Taylor area are prominently African Americans and Jews. And we need to have some diversity where that money is spent all over Cleveland Heights, not just in one particular area. And that right there, I am tired of it. We pay taxes. We are a part of this area. We are not getting what we need in this area. And if we're supporting and our taxpayers' money is going to help out and build in this community, then we need to have some building in areas in this area as well.
Okay, Mike, I saw your hand up. Go ahead.
Again, I can't, then now I can unmute. Amy, can you turn it over to us so that we can mute and unmute ourselves, or?
You should be able to. I'm unmuting and muting you now.
You are?
Yeah, but you should be able to do it yourself.
I'm just caught. Maybe the my computer's mad at me this evening. I don't know. So look, you know, I can't sit here and be silent about this. I very much respect everything DeVita is saying, but this ain't Future Heights' fault. The council owns this. We, you know, what Future Heights was doing was no secret. It was run past all of us. I'm looking at my fellow council members. We were all on board with exactly what they were doing and when they were doing it. They came in and they told us they were focusing very intently on the area around the high school. Everybody said that's a great idea in light of this and that. We had all sorts of favorable public comment. And to suggest that somehow Future Heights of all organizations isn't paying attention to Noble is nonsense. Just nonsense. I've experienced it myself. I mean, they basically are the reasons for the Noble Road Corridor project. They lined that whole thing up. They had there's an amazing amount of professional expertise brought to bear on a very complicated plan. Very complicated plan. If memory serves, they were the ones who were running the planning charrettes for Noble. And we can be dismissive if you choose to be of Noble Neighbors, but that is arguably one of the most important neighborhood groups and association, most active and engaged neighborhood groups around. And I wouldn't even think of doing anything in Noble without going to them and getting their input. So I applaud. Look, I was the one who said we need to elevate the focus on Noble. Maybe what we need is a discussion that just focuses on Noble, because it's far more holistic. It's easy to point the finger at Future Heights and say, you know, you're to blame for things not happening there. That's just nonsense. It's just completely not fair to Future Heights. That we can give the direction that we talked about earlier, but that will be a different direction than we gave to our CDC partners at the beginning. We can pivot and we can change and we can do certain things, but we need the input of our professional staff. We need to look at ourselves with respect to this. We need the input of professional staff, and we need to be respectful of what council's role is here, which is not to execute, not to administer, not to manage, not to tell people how they do their jobs. Okay, that's not the role of a city council in a council manager form of government, which is what we are right now. It'll soon be on the mayor's plate. That's just not our job, to sit here and micromanage and tell people what they need to be doing. Okay. And I'm happy to have a conversation about Noble, and I love Noble, and it kills me. Everything DeVita says about what's happening in Noble is true. I'm not knocking that for a second. And just wonderful people live over in the Noble neighborhood, and we do need to pay very close attention to it. But doing it this way, trying to lay this on the doorstep of Future Heights, I'm not having any of it. It's not fair.
Wait a minute. Let's be clear. Let's be very clear. I am not laying any blame on Future Heights or Noble Neighbors. Wait a minute. I'm blaming everybody. Everybody on council, because prior to me coming to council, that's what was happening. The last six houses that came in the Noble area only came because I said I was not voting unless these six houses came to Noble area. That's the only reason we got these last six houses. You're talking about another 3 to 4 years before anything is happening in the Noble area. Yes, we are council, but yes, we should be able to direct.
That's just not accurate.
But why it's not accurate?
It's just not.
Is anybody on this panel here?
Because we just got
Jason. Remember, the last six houses here.
DeVita, listen to Mary.
Hold on, Mike and DeVita. Let me just say something here.
It's not fair.
That first, I think that DeVita is expressing a frustration that is very real in a part of the city, Noble, Hearts of Taylor. This is exactly. The frustration is that we're seeing building and investment and city involvement in parts of the city, but just a lot of, you know, maybe talk or benches in our parts of the city. And that's the frustration that DeVita's representing right now. And it's a real frustration. And that's how we got into this situation. So DeVita, what she's saying, a lot of it is right. And this council may have been absolutely wrong the way we went about our partnership at the beginning, but without focusing on the hardest hit areas of the city, the hardest hit areas, which are clearly Noble and a part of Taylor, the DeSoto Altamont area. Those are clearly the hardest hit parts of the city that are lagging behind everybody else. That's what I'm hearing DeVita say, that we can't wait. We need to focus on our hardest hit areas.
Flower pots and benches dump up my property value. I love Noble Neighbors. I love the work they're doing. I love Future Heights. I love the work they're doing. But my property value is just as important as everybody else's in this area. Flower pots don't help my property value. Benches don't help my property value. Vacant lots don't help my property value. Nothing that's happening in this area is helping my property value. I pay taxes here too. So do everyone else in the Noble and Taylor area. So pivot and come back to this area. That's what I'm saying.
So there was a lot of discussion about how to divide up the task of revitalizing our city. And I think it got divided the way it did, with the city doing the RFQ, you know, because the city wanted to take that on. And so there's a history here of why it's the way it is, but I think things should start to happen, DeVita. I can understand your frustration, but once we get the RFQ going and so on, once that's settled, hopefully things will move a lot faster. And 40 homes is a lot. So 40 lots or 60 or whatever it was.
But Mary, I think DeVita, what her frustration is that a hope isn't enough, that council has to direct.
I know.
And that's what DeVita's saying. We need to make sure to direct before our next contract where we want the focus of our CDC to be. And that's not hope. That's an actual direction from council.
Well, the focus they have now is what was negotiated or worked out. So anyway.
Well, work it out. However it's done, work it out.
Okay. Worked out. I think we should move on.
Okay. Okay, and I agree with Mary. However, anyone else want to speak before we do move on? Or can we move on? Okay, good. All right, so thank you, Deanna, for coming. We are gonna move on now to our delayed meeting with Metro Health. Very exciting development that council is, we're all aware of it, and we're all very excited about Metro expanding here in Cleveland Heights, and to address a need that is very real here in all of Cuyahoga County, but specifically the east side suburbs are gonna really benefit from this. And Dr. Bruner?
Good evening. Hi, I'm Julia Bruner, I'm from Metro Health. I think I met a couple of you in the last few weeks. Joe Froelich, are you on?
I am, yes. For some reason, I don't seem to have video, but, oh, wait a minute. Let's try this.
You have to press the button.
All right, there I am.
And then I think, can you guys see my screen? Yes, okay, I see Amy nodding her head, excellent. All right, so Joe, go ahead.
So, yeah, thank you. I'm Joe Froelich. I'm a senior vice president of the Metro Health System for communications, community, and government relations. And I'm also a 39-year resident of Cleveland Heights. And in that capacity, I'm especially honored to be here to introduce you to what we think is a very exciting project for the overall health of Cuyahoga County and for the city of Cleveland Heights. After many years now, we've all heard concerns about the lack of treatment options for our family members and neighbors who suffer from mental illness or substance abuse disorder. This project is an attempt by Metro Health, Cuyahoga County's public safety net hospital, to address that gap and to do what it's been doing for 183 years, which is to assist in making the people of our county healthier. With that, let me ask Dr. Julia Bruner, who will serve as president of our Behavioral Health Initiative at Cleveland Heights Medical Center, to tell you what we plan to do and why we think it's so important.
Okay. Thank you, Joe. Good evening, everybody. And I'd like to start off by saying thank you for inviting Metro Health to your meeting this evening. We feel it's very important for us to talk through this expansion of the inpatient facility at Cleveland Heights with you directly and get your input as we move forward. As Joe mentioned, there is an overwhelming need in relation to access to mental health care for our families and our friends and our neighbors. And to that point, the Cuyahoga County health initiative group put forward the fact that enhancing mental health and reducing substance abuse within our county was within the top five community needs in 2019. And as we look at the benchmarks around the number of beds that are required within a community and compare that to what we have in our county and in Northeast Ohio, we recognize that there's a 200 plus bed gap in relation to inpatient beds for behavioral health. And that that doesn't include some of the special circumstances that our region have in relation to individuals who are in inpatient facilities for forensic reasons, or the facilities are private pay only, or they're adult only, resulting in gaps for geriatric patients and for adolescents. And we recognize that one in four Americans suffer from some form of mental illness, such as depression, anxiety, or bipolar disorder. And having a facility that allows people to have a short-term stay to stabilize their mental health condition will not only benefit Cleveland Heights area and its community members, as well as other community members across the area. So the next slide shows you what the plan is in relation to this hospital design. And what you can see is that on the slide itself, in blue is the expansion of the hospital space. So we would be building new and attaching it to the current existing Cleveland Heights building, which is in gray. There'd be 75,000 square feet of new construction on MetroHealth property and 21,000 square feet of renovation within the established buildings that are the emergency department and the already in place hospital, as well as in the outpatient facility. We would be expanding access to outpatient care in relation to behavioral health. This addition allows us to expand the services that are in the Cleveland Heights area for adolescent patients, adults, and geriatric patients. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Joe to talk more about the nuts and bolts of how it impacts Cleveland Heights.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Bruner. As you see, the this new behavioral health hospital addition will be owned and operated by the Metro Health System. We're going to build on the existing property that we have there, right off of Severn Circle. It's going to be a capital investment of $42 million. We will not need any incentives from the City of Cleveland Heights to do this. Although I would be remiss at this point if I didn't mention that we are going to, we expect to get a $5 million contribution from Cuyahoga County, money from the opioid settlement. A resolution to that effect is going to be introduced tomorrow at the County Council meeting, sponsored by Executive Armin Budish, Council President Dan Brady, and Councilwoman Cheryl Stevens. What we are going to do, what we propose to do here, will not in any way impact or reduce the services that we already deliver at the existing Heights Hospital. We have an emergency department, we have 12 bed inpatient facility, and a full range of outpatient services, including primary care, ophthalmology, and physical therapy, and that's just the ones I've used in the past year. So. We see in 2019, we saw 90,000 patients in Cleveland Heights. We had a payroll of just under 200 people, or just under 200 people, and a payroll of $14.6 million. The hospital will, our existing hospital will remain the home of the regional dispatch center, and we will have 24 hour, 7 day a week security provided by the Metro Health Police Department, as we do at all our hospitals, and as we do right now at Cleveland Heights. So our plan is to, assuming that we are in the design and build phase, or design and planning phase right now, our hope is that we can begin construction, break ground in the spring of next year, and actually begin construction early summer. And the goal is that we would occupy this new hospital in the fall of 2022, which is at the same time we'll be opening the new tower here on the main campus of Metro Health. we expect that we will spend roughly of that $42 million, $12 million will be taken up with salaried labor wages during construction. We pay prevailing wage. This will be a design build project, and we will build in targets and goals for diversity in hiring and subcontracting. In the first year that we're open, we expect to have about 155 full-time employees, a payroll of just under $10 million. By the time everything is up and fully operational in year five, we're looking at a payroll of 225 full-time employees and a payroll of $15 million. So we think over the course of those first 6 years from construction to up and running, the new income tax revenue to Cleveland Heights will be about $1.76 million. Just point out that MetroHealth has a $15 an hour minimum wage for all our employees. And in fact, we gave folks a raise even in the middle of this year to our frontline employees, even in the midst of COVID and the impact that was having on the system. And the other thing I just want to say is I think that the investment and the commitment that we're planning here, I think aligns very well with the city's goals of revitalizing Severance. It's right in step with what's in your master plan. And again, as a resident, I think it's an exciting possibility to be able to do that. And we very much appreciate the initial enthusiasm and support we have gotten from you, Mayor Stein, and from City Manager O'Neill and the other folks on the staff. And we look forward to opening the dialogue with you. We will answer any questions you have. If we don't have answers, we will find them. We look at tonight as kind of the beginning of a long discussion and an expansion of our relationship. The city's been a really good neighbor to us in the years we've been at Cleveland Heights. We think it's, and that's one of the reasons we're interested in expanding there. So we look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Mary, go ahead.
This may not exactly be a question for the Metro people as much as for city employees, because the roadway at Severance, the ring road, is in need of repair. And I was wondering who's responsible for that. Is that a city responsibility, or is it the owner of Severance Center?
I believe we took that on years ago, Mary.
Okay.
But I will research and find out exactly what the agreement is.
Well, it could be better. That's what I guess I would say.
Yes. I know we're not responsible for their parking lot, however, which is really in disarray, but yeah. I will look into it, Mary.
Okay. This is really exciting, and I'm thrilled. So thank you very much, and looking forward to this as it evolves. So again, hooray.
Great. Thank you. Yeah,
thank you.
Joe, I just want to say hello again.
Hey, how are you? Good to see you, Councilwoman.
Very good to see you as well. I want to say thank you so very much for the presentation. It was wonderful. And I am so happy and eager for Cleveland Heights for this new development. I've had some calls actually from other hospitals who are not very happy about this expansion. And I told them as long as it's coming to Cleveland Heights, they're out of business, because I am definitely going with Metro to expand and do whatever we can to help Cleveland Heights, especially Severance Circle. We need it. We need it so badly. So thank you so much for even thinking about expanding and making more revenue and jobs here. And you know, I was so impressed to know that the wage will be at least $15 an hour and not below. So for 250 people or more, that is wonderful. So I thank you, and as I take that hat off and put on my union hat, we thank you as well.
Great. Thank you, Councilwoman. And I would point out that, even with what we propose, there is sadly enormous need in our community for behavioral health services. And that what even as big a dent as we think we can make in this, there is demand to go around for other folks as well.
Yeah. I know Greater Cleveland Congregations has had this on their radar for a while, of having these types of centers. So I'm really happy that this is going into place.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think as Joe said, there is great need across the community in relation to these beds. As I pointed out, there's a need for more than 200 beds in Northeast Ohio. We're moving forward with advancing 110 in Cleveland Heights. So there is plenty of room for all of us to help take care of people better.
And I didn't see you in that corner, but thank you so very much for your presentation as well.
Yeah, thank you.
Khalil.
Yeah, I had a quick question. I'm just sort of, I guess, fortuitously, the county also announced the diversion center that they'll be working on creating. And I know that there's a veterans treatment court docket. I know that this is a different sort of entity than those would be, but I'm wondering, is there any room for working with sort of a veterans treatment docket, or even sort of thinking about transitioning from a diversion center once somebody's stabilized and sort of has resolved whatever criminal issues that brought them to the diversion center? Is there any room for this behavioral health center to work with either of those entities to help augment the care that they're receiving?
So the intention of the diversion center and this hospital and all of the above is really to ensure that we have good communications among all the various mental health agencies and recovery agencies that we have across our region. And when we can connect people up to care, we will connect people up to care. We want to make sure people have what they need so that they can heal and go about recovering what they've lost in their life.
Thank you.
Yes. Mike.
Yeah, I just want to echo the sentiments of my colleagues and thank MetroHealth. This is a very exciting project. I'm appreciative of the way you're going about this. I'm appreciative of the commitment to community engagement. I'm appreciative of the way you've already engaged our staff. You know, this fits in, as Joe said it better than I'll say it, this fits in really well with our master plan and strategic plan, you know, and, you know, in an era where everything seems to be about the vaccine, frankly, this represents that proverbial shot in the arm for severance in particular and for our city in general. That's just what we're looking for. So I'm really looking forward to working with you and your team to make this become a reality. Yeah, yeah. For choosing Cleveland Heights.
I think we want to make sure that we are available to you. So when questions arise, we can talk through them and work through any of the challenges that we may be facing. So I believe the group has my contact information. I know the group has Joe's contact information. We want to make sure that we are addressing things as they move along. It is a tight timeline, as you can see, you know, so we're talking in less than 2 years, the building will be up and filled. At least that's my hope. So we want to make sure that we engage with you and you share where your challenges are and what you see the needs of your community. And let's work together to make something great.
And I want to say that just working with you and others on the team the last couple weeks has been terrific. Great exchange of information. Anything that you need, we are in a partnership with you and very excited about the project. So doing great and looking forward to the future.
Thank you. I know Dr. Boutros, our CEO, is very excited about this. Very much appreciative of the gracious response we've gotten from the folks in Cleveland Heights. And, you know, we're very committed to this. This is all part of his vision of how do we create a healthier community. And we know that that goes beyond just, you know, what goes on within the four walls of a hospital. So strengthening what the treatment will provide is the healing that Julia mentioned is going to be really important, but it's also about building stronger communities. So we're really proud to make the investment in Cleveland Heights. That really goes to, again, his vision of how we serve this broader Cuyahoga County.
Wonderful.
Mary.
So a long time ago, long time ago, I read One Flew Over a Cuckoo's Nest and I watched the movie. And I think that was what closed down all the mental health hospitals in the country. And it's taken decades to get to that what was supposed to happen was that it was supposed to shift to the community level. So it's astonishing how long it's taken us to get to where we are now. But I'm, you know, better late than never. Hooray. So, so thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, well, we look forward to having some community engagement, public outreach, educating the neighbors and the residents about this exciting development, and then hopefully April's groundbreaking.
Great, thank you. We do too.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Have a great night.
Thank you so much. Have a good night.
Happy Thanksgiving, folks.
Happy Thanksgiving.
You too. Happy Thanksgiving.
Okay, so we're going to be adjourning the committee, the whole meeting.
Bye.
And we'll take a 5-minute break. When we come back, we will begin our council meeting.